Small Steps, The Year I Got Polio, by Peg Kehret, narrated by Susan Boyce. Prologue. Before a polio vaccine was developed, polio killed or crippled thousands of people each year. A president of the United States, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, got polio as a young father. He spent the rest of his life in a wheelchair, using hip-high leg braces and a cane when he needed to stand to make a speech. Children, however, are more likely to get polio than adults are. It is a highly contagious disease, and in 1949, there were 42,033 cases reported in the United States. There was only one case diagnosed that year in Austin, Minnesota, a 12-year-old girl, Peg Schulz, me. The disease's full name is poliomyelitis, or infantile paralysis, but it is usually called polio. The polio virus attacks the nerve cells which control the muscles of the body. If damage to the nerve cells is slight, the muscle weakness will be temporary. If the virus kills many nerve cells, paralysis will be extensive and possibly permanent. There is no cure for polio. There are no miracle medicines to stop the damage to nerve cells or repair those already damaged. When I began to write about my polio days, long-forgotten memories bubbled to the surface. I was astonished by the intense emotions these memories brought with them. Those months, more than any other time of my life, molded my personality. Since I have no transcript of these events, the dialogue is not strictly accurate, but the people mentioned are all real people. The incidents all happened, and the voices are as close to reality as I can make them. Although I used fictional techniques to write this book, I can verify my feelings about everything that happened, and feelings are the most important part of any story. 1. The diagnosis. My ordeal began on a Friday early in September. In school that morning, I glanced at the clock often, eager for the homecoming parade at 4 o'clock. As a seventh grader, it was my first chance to take part in the homecoming fun. For a week, my friends and I had spent every spare moment working on the seventh grade float, and we were sure it would win first prize. My last class before lunch was chorus. I loved to sing, and we were practicing a song whose lyrics are the inscription on the Statue of Liberty. Usually the words, "Give me your tired, your poor," brought goosebumps to my arms. But on homecoming day, I was distracted by a twitching muscle in my left thigh. As I sang, a section of my blue skirt popped up and down as if jumping beans lived in my leg. I pressed my hand against my thigh, trying to make the muscle be still. But it leaped and jerked beneath my fingers. I stretched my leg forward and rotated the ankle. Twitch, twitch. Next, I tightened my leg muscles for a few seconds and then relaxed them. Nothing helped. The bell rang. When I started toward my locker, my legs buckled as if I had nothing but cotton inside my skin. I collapsed, scattering my books on the floor. Someone yelled, "Peg fainted!" But I knew I had not fainted because my eyes stayed open and I was conscious. I sat on the floor for a moment while my classmates collected my books. "Are you all right?" my friend Karen asked as she helped me stand up. "Yes. I don't know what happened. You look pale." "I'm fine," I insisted. "Really?" I put my books in my locker and went home for lunch, as I did every day. 2 days earlier, I'd gotten a sore throat and headache. Now I also felt weak and my back hurt. What rotten timing, I thought, to get sick on homecoming day. Although my legs felt wobbly, I walked the 12 blocks home. I didn't tell my mother about the fall or about my headache and other problems because I knew she would make me stay home. I didn't want to miss that parade. I was glad to sit down to eat lunch. Maybe, I thought, I should not have stayed up so late the night before. Or maybe I'm just hungry. As soon as I eat, I won't feel so weak. When I reached for my glass of milk, my hand shook so hard I couldn't pick up the glass. I grasped it with both hands. They trembled so badly that milk sloshed over the side. My mother put her hand on my forehead. "You feel hot," she said. "You're going straight to bed." It was a relief to lie down. I wondered why my back hurt. I hadn't lifted anything heavy. I couldn't imagine why I was so tired either. I felt as if I had not slept in days. I fell asleep right away and woke 3 hours later with a stiff neck. My back hurt even more than it had earlier, and now my legs ached as well. Several times, I had painful muscle spasms in my legs and toes. The muscles tightened until my knees bent and my toes curled, and I was unable to straighten my legs or toes until the spasms gradually passed. I looked at the clock. The homecoming parade started in 15 minutes. "I want to go to the parade," I said. Mother stuck a thermometer in my mouth, said, 102, and called the doctor. The seventh grade float would have to win first place without me. I went back to sleep. Dr. Wright came, took my temperature, listened to my breathing, and talked with Mother. Mother sponged my forehead with a cold cloth. I dozed, woke, and slept again. At midnight, I began to vomit. Mother and Dad helped me to the bathroom. We all assumed I had the flu. Dr. Wright returned before breakfast the next morning and took my temperature again. "Still 102, he said. He helped me sit up, with my feet dangling over the side of the bed. He tapped my knees with his rubber mallet. This was supposed to make my legs jerk. They didn't. They hung limp and unresponsive. I was too woozy from pain and fever to care. He ran his fingernail across the bottom of my foot from the heel to the toes. It felt awful, but I couldn't pull my foot away. He did the same thing on the other foot, with the same effect. I wished he would leave me alone so I could sleep. "I need to do a spinal tap on her," he told my parents. "Can you take her to the hospital right away?" Dad helped me out of bed. I was too sick to get dressed. At the hospital, I lay on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.